Hello everyone, myself Abhilash, Bio Faculty, Vishwamanava Composite PU College, Chitradurga. Today we are going to discuss a new chapter of first PU biology, that is locomotion and movement. Everyone know that locomotion and movement are not the same things, they are different to each other. First study the differences between locomotion and movement. Locomotion is defined as moving away from the original position of an organism, whereas movement can happen with or without moving away from an organism's original position. Movement can be performed by both plants and animals, whereas locomotion performed only by animals. Locomotion process is always a voluntary process, whereas movement may be voluntary or involuntary in action. Locomotion takes place at an organism level, whereas movement takes place at biological level. Locomotion does not necessity or require an energy, but movement requires energy. Next, types of movement. Movement can be categorized into three types, namely amoeboid movement, ciliary movement, and muscular movement. In amoeboid movement, this movement is brought by the help of pseudopodia, that is false legs. Example, macrophage and leukocytes move with the help of pseudopodia and engulf pathogens. Ciliary movement. Most of our internal tubular organs are lined by ciliated epithelium. These, which are present in the trachea, helps in removing dust particles. In spinal cord, the ciliary movement help in cerebrospinal movement. Muscular movement. The muscular tissue help in the movement and locomotion, that is, that helps in the movement of eyelids, tongue, limbs, blood with blood vessels, heart, and etc. This movement requires coordination between muscular, skeletal, and nervous activities. Muscles. Muscles are mesodermal in origin. Based on their structures, they are classified into three types: skeletal muscle, smooth muscle, and cardiac muscle. Smooth muscles are located in the wall of hollow organs, vessels, and respiratory passageways, whereas cardiac muscle, as the name indicates, they are found in heart, whereas skeletal muscles, they are attached to bones. If you see the characters of three muscles, the smooth muscles are tapering at their ends, branching network, and they are non-striated. They does not contain light and dark bands. Whereas cardiac muscles have branching network, they are lightly strained, and they are uninucleate, that consist of single nucleus. Whereas skeletal muscles are long and cylindrical, multinucleated, and they are heavily striated with light and dark bands. If you see their control action, both smooth muscles and cardiac muscles are involuntary in their action, whereas skeletal muscles are voluntary in their action. Then we discuss skeletal muscles. It is made up of muscle bundles known as fascicles, held together by collagens, connective tissue known as fascia. Each muscle bundle contains of number of muscle fibers. Each muscle fibers is lined by plasma membrane. Here plasma membrane we call them as sarcolemma. So in this structure we can see the sarcolemma here. Here we can see sarcolemma as well as the sarcoplasm. Each muscle fiber is lined by plasma membrane, as we know that is known as sarcolemma, enclosing sarcoplasm. Partially arranged myofibrils are present in muscle bundle, having alternate light and dark bands due to the presence of protein known as actin as well as myosin. In this anatomical structure, that is the second diagram, we can observe both light and dark bands. Next, we discuss skeletal system in a detailed way. Light band contains actin and it is known as I band. So in this structure we can see I band, that is known as isotropic band. Dark band contain myosins and they are known as A band, that is anisotropic band. Here we can see A band also. Both bands are present parallel to each other in longitudinal fashion. In center of each I band is elastic fiber known as called as Z line. So we can see a Z line also. Then in the middle of A band, thin fibrous M line is present. So we can visualize M line here. The portion of myofibrils between two successive Z line is the functional unit of contraction called sarcomere. At resting stage, thin filaments overlaps the thick filament. The part of thick filament not overlapped is known as H zone. So in this region H zone, there is no overlapping is present, known as H zone. Now we discuss two proteins, that is actin as well as myosin. First we discuss myosin. Myosin is a primary protein, primary contractile protein. Myosin is a polymer, so it is made up of several monomers. The monomers of myosin known as meromyosin. Each meromyosin is made up of two portions, one is tail portion and another one is head portion. So we can visualize both tail as well as head portion. The head portion is made up of heavy meromyosin, that is HMM, and tail portion is made up of light meromyosin, that is LMM. The head consists of two parts, namely actin binding site as well as ATP binding site. Next we discuss actin. Actin, it is a secondary contractile protein. It is made up of F actin. Each actin protein is a polymer called known as G protein. G protein means globular protein. Globular protein is made up of two chains. They are coiled to each other. So in this structure, we can visualize two rounded chain-like structures. In between two protein, actin, one filament is in between two protein of actin, one filament is present called tropomyosin. So this structure, the line, blue line, what it pass is known as tropomyosin. And the tropomyosin at intervals having one more protein known as troponin. Both tropomyosin and troponin at resting stage, they block the active sites of actin filaments. Next, we discuss the mechanism of muscles contraction. So, the mechanism of muscles contraction can be explained by sliding filament theory. So, in which the thin filament is slide over thick filament. Muscles contraction start with signal sent by central nervous system via motor neuron. Neural signal releases neurotransmitter, that is acetylcholine, to generate action potential in the sarcolemma. This causes the release of calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Calcium activates actin, which binds to myosin head to form cross bridge. So here in first diagram we can observe cross bridge formation. This cross bridge pulls the actin filaments, causing them to slide over the myosin. Calcium are then returned to the sarcoplasmic reticulum, which inactivate the actin. Cross bridges are broken and the muscles are relaxes. Then muscles are classified into two types, namely red fibers and white fibers. Red fibers contains myoglobin that has plenty of mitochondria that use large amount of oxygen stored in them. Whereas white fibers, the muscles fibers contain less number of myoglobin called white fibers. Then we discuss human skeletal system. And we know that human skeletal system is divided into two types. One is endoskeletal system and another one is exoskeletal system. Endoskeletal system, the skeletal system lie inside the body and only visualized by x-rays. For example, mammals, fish, birds have internal skeletal. Whereas exoskeleton, the skeleton of the animals that looks on the outside. That can be seen in animals such as insects, spiders, and crustaceans. Then we discuss human endoskeleton system. The human endoskeleton system consists of 206 bones. These 206 bones are categorized into two portions. One is axial endoskeleton and appendicular endoskeleton. Axial endoskeleton consists of 80 bones, whereas appendicular endoskeletal system consists of 126 bones, totally 206 bones. This axial skeleton, 80 bones are divided into four regions. That is, in skull we have 29 bones, in vertebrae we have 26 bones, in sternum we have only one bone, whereas in ribs we have 12 bones. Let's discuss one by one in detail. So first we discuss axial skeleton. The axial skeleton system consists of 80 bones, in which 29 bones found in skull region, 26 in vertebrae, 1 in sternum, and 12 pairs, that is 24 bones in ribs. So cranium, we simply call them as brain box, which covers the brain. The cranium consists of 8 bones, namely 1 frontal bone and 2 parietal bone, 2 temporal bone, 1 occipital bone, 1 sphenoid bone, and 1 ethmoid bone. So here we can visualize all the 8 bones. So this is parietal, this is occipital, this is frontal, this is sphenoid, this is ethmoid. Next we discuss facial bones. In our face we have 14 bones. So 2 nasal bones, 2 lacrimal bones, one is nasal concha, 2 nasal concha, 2 maxilla, 1 mandible, 1 omer, 2 zygomorphic, and 2 palatine bones. Then we have auditory bones. Auditory bones are 6 in number. Each ear consists of 3 bones. These 3 are smallest bones, that is incus, malus, as well as stapes. And next, hyoid bone or tongue bone. This hyoid or tongue bone is only one bone present in human body, that is just above the larynx portion. Next we discuss vertebral column. The human vertebral column consists of 26 bones. In this, these 26 bones are divided into 5 categories, that is cervical, thoracic, lumbar, sacrum, and coccus. The cervical consists of 7 bones. They are vertebrae of neck region. The first two cervical vertebrae are known as atlas and axis. They do not have intervertebral disc between them. Next we have thoracic vertebrae, which consist of 12 bones. They are 12 movable vertebrae supporting for the thoracic region. Next, lumbar vertebrae. They are 5 movable vertebrae supporting the abdominal region. Next, sacral vertebrae. They are 5 in number, fused to form one composite structure called sacrum, supporting the pelvic region. And caudal vertebrae, they are 4 in number, fused to form one, that is coccus. Next, we discuss sternum or breastbone. It is a narrow, flat, runs along with the mid-ventral region of the thoracic cage. It is differentiated into 3 regions, namely manubrium, body, and xiphoid process. Manubrium is the anterior portion of sternum. The first two pairs of ribs articulated with the sternum by sternal cartilage. Body, the major part, that is 3rd to 7th pair of ribs are attached to the body. Xiphoid process, it is a posterior part attachment of diaphragm and some abdominal muscles. Next we discuss ribs. There are 12 in pair, that is total 24 ribs. They are arranged one below the other, and the gap between the ribs are known as intercostal space. Each rib is an arched flat bone made up of anterior cartilaginous part and the posterior bony part. The ribs are categorized into 3 portions, true ribs, false ribs, as well as floating ribs. True ribs, these are the first seven pairs of ribs which are directly attached to the sternum, in which first and second are attached to manubrium part, as well as third and seventh are attached to body part. False ribs, they are three in pair, that is 8th, 9th and 10th. These are the three pairs of ribs which are connected to cartilage to the ribs above them and not directly with sternum. So these false ribs are not directly connected to sternum. The last 11th and 12th pair of ribs are known as floating ribs, which are not attached to the sternum and remains free and floating. Okay, next we discuss appendicular skeletal system. The appendicular skeletal system consists of 126 bones, in which both forelimbs and hind limbs consist of 60 bones, that is 120, and we have two girdle, pectoral and pelvic girdle, which consist of 4 plus 2 bones, that is 6 bones, totally 126 bones. We know that human consists of a pair of forelimbs. Each forelimb consists of 30 bones, that is forelimb consists of 60 bones. So the forelimb consists of humerus, radius, ulna. Then we have carpels, metacarpals and phalanges. Humerus are 1 in number, radius 1, ulna 1. Carpels are 8 in number, metacarpals 5 in number, phalanges are 14 in number, totally 30 bones. In the same way, hind limbs. Hind limb consists of 30 bones. Femur is the longest bone in the human body. Then fibula, then tibia, tarsals, metatarsals, as well as digits. So hind limb also consists of 30 bones. So one hind limb consists of 30 bones. So hind limb are pair, that is 60. Forelimb are also pair, that is 60, which consists of 120 bones. We have a girdle, namely pectoral and pelvic girdle. The pectoral girdle or shoulder girdle is the set of bones which connects the upper limb of the axial skeleton on each side, which consists of clavicle and scapula. So in diagram we can observe clavicle as well as scapula. The pelvic girdle consists of a complete ring composed of three bones, two hip, that is coxal bone, as well as one sacrum, is also a part of vertebral column. So in this diagram we can observe sacrum also. Next we discuss joints. Joints are the meeting point or junction between two or more bones or cartilages. Joints are can be categorized into three portions: fibrous, that is immovable joints; cartilaginous, slightly movable joints; synovial, freely movable joints. So in this picture we can observe various type of joints. First one, we can observe the pivot joint or no joint. Pivot joint, here the rounded projection of one bone protrudes into a ring of another bone, due to which rotatory movement is possible only in the direction. Example, odontoid process of axis fits to the cavity of atlas. So in this portion we observe pivot joint. Next we observe hinge joint, that is S joint. Here the articular surfaces are pulley shaped. Movements are permitted in one plane around the transverse axis. Example, joint between the skull and the first vertebra, elbow joint as well as ankle joint. Next we discuss saddle joint. Here the articular surfaces of one bone is concave and the other is convex. This is seen in thumb between the metacarpals as well as carpals. Next we discuss ball and socket joint. Here ball shaped head of one bone fits into the cup like socket of another bone. It can be seen in shoulder and hip joint. Next we can discuss plane or gilding joint. Here the articular surface are usually flat and they glide or slip over each other. Example, between carpal bones. So now we discuss few neat question. Passage of ova through female reproductive tract is facilitated by option A, ciliary movement, amoeboid movement, flagellar movement and cyclosis. So the correct option for this is option A, ciliary movement. There are three main types of movement shown by the cells of the human body, namely amoeboid, ciliary and muscular movement. The cilia of the fallopian tube, that is oviducts, show movement for the transport of ova inside the reproductive tract. Second question, the functional unit of contractile system in a striated muscle is sarcomere, Z-band, crossbridge and myofibril. The answer is sarcomere, because sarcomere is the functional unit of myofibril. It contains two types of protein filaments called actin and myosin. These filaments slide upon other to bring the contraction of muscles. Next, which of the following statements about the striated muscles is incorrect? So, option in the center of each eye band is an elastic fiber, that is Z line, which bisects it. Thin filaments are firmly attached to the Z line. M line is a fibrous membrane in the middle of A bands and none of this. So, the answer is option D, none of this, because a myofibril has a dark and light bands. The dark band called A band at the center, a comparatively less dark zone called H zone in the center of H zone is the M line. So each I band has at its center a dark membrane called Z line. The part of myofibril between two successive Z line is called sarcomere. In fact, each sarcomere is a bundle of thick and thin myofilaments. If a stimulus several times greater than the threshold stimulus is provided to a muscle fiber, it will contract with a longer force, contract with a smaller force, contract with the same force and undergo tetany. So the correct answer for this is option C, contract with the same force. A muscle fiber would contract only when it receives a stimulus at a certain intensity called threshold stimulus. Response to a muscle fiber to a stimulus is not proportionate to its intensity. At above the threshold value, a muscle fiber will always contract with the maximum force irrespective of the strength of the stimulus. So last question is, in the resting muscle fibers, tropomyosin partially covers calcium binding sites of troponin, actin binding sites of myosin, myosin binding sites of actin, calcium binding sites of actin. So the correct answer is option C. When the muscle is at rest, the tropomyosin muscle covers the binding site of actin molecule where the interaction with myosin occurs. Lastly, thank you.